Do you want to learn more about software product licensing models? If you are planning to sell a software product, you need to consider what licensing model that product should be using, because choosing the incorrect one could mean that you lose out on a lot of revenue. However, choosing the correct one is not always that easy. To help you out, this video will cover everything you need to know about software licensing models. I will give you 7 useful licensing models and guide you to which one your product should be implementing so that you can price it correctly and get more customers. I'm Joe Norman with Cryptolens. Let's get started. The most basic licensing model is called a perpetual licensing model, where a customer pays once for the product and is able to use it forever. An appropriate product to sell with a perpetual license key would be a simple and cheap software tool that is sold to customers rather than businesses. A tool that cleans code could be one relevant example. In reality, this is how a perpetual license works. A customer buys the product for $5 and can use it forever. You can even use a slightly different licensing model called the try and buy, where you let the future customer use the product for free during an initial test period. That allows the future customers to experience the value of your product for free, and is then more likely to pay for that value after the trial. But there are some problems with the perpetual model. The model means that you give up a lot of control of your software, and a lot of customers will be stuck on an old version. From a business perspective, selling a product at a one-time price gives you a lot of unpredictability. One month, your revenue might be high because you get a lot of customers, while the next month, your revenue might not be able to cover your expenses. These points make the perpetual license model inappropriate to use for more advanced software products, especially if you are selling B2B. As a result of the drawbacks, the subscription licensing model has become more and more popular in recent times. Here's why. Subscriptions give a business more control over the product and more predictability to the monthly revenue. This is where the more advanced software products come in, such as a SaaS product. Let's say that this product is so advanced that it would require a one-time price of $500. A lot of users might not be willing to pay such a high price, even if they get a trial period. Instead of selling the product as a one-time price, subscription fees are established, whereby a customer has to pay a smaller but continuous subscription fee to keep using the product. If the customer stops paying, they are no longer able to access the product. You can now publish software updates and have more control over your application. The continuous license fee also gives your company more revenue predictability. If you have 500 customers paying the price of $10 per month, you know for sure that you will get around $5,000 in monthly revenue. More customers are also able to get started with the product, since they only face a $10 per month price instead of the steep $500 one-time price. But that also highlights some problems with the subscription licensing model. If the product warrants a one-time price of $500, it would take 50 months or over 4 years to claim that money. However, this is where the method called feature locking comes in. Feature locking solves the issue where a continuous subscription fee would make the product too cheap for serious customers. You can then lock the more advanced features and have the serious customers pay extra for them. This is commonly done by setting up different pricing plans, a light and pro version, for example. However, not all products can set up different pricing plans. You need to make sure that the light version has just the right set of basic features for the customers to still get value. And knowing where that limit is can be a challenge. It is definitely worth the struggle, since you would then have customers who get a lot of value from your product to pay more than smaller users. The last thing I want to mention about the subscription model is a special case where you can charge customers based on the actual value they receive. Let's suppose that your product has a clear output that all customers receive value from. For music creation software, that output would be the completed song file. Then, it would be appropriate to set up a usage-based licensing model and charge customers a standard price every time they receive the value. If a small user of the music creation software only downloads 5 music files 1 month, they would only have to pay $5 in this example. If a bigger user downloads 50 music files, the price for that month would instead be $50. If it is possible to set up a usage-based pricing model for your company, I would highly suggest doing so, since you can charge customers in exact relation to how much value they receive from your product. But not all products have such a clear output factor, and users might receive value from different actions, and then the usage-based approach is not appropriate. So that was my rather long introduction to the subscription licensing model. Let's now more briefly cover the floating and node-locked licensing model and then end the video with a mention of the account-based licensing model. Floating and node-locked licenses are great if you're selling a product that allows for multiple seats. Let's say that a customer buys your application and wants 3 employees to be able to run it. You can then set up a pricing model that allows for 3 employees to use the same license key, and in this case, a floating license key. You would then tell the software licensing system to only allow 3 concurrent users to run the application with the same floating license key. If a 4th one tries to enter, they will be denied, because this customer only paid for 3 seats. If they want more, they have to pay more. Great, so how does that differ from a node-locked license key? Well, when one user exits the application, a floating license key would allow another employee in, since floating licenses only count the number of concurrent machines. Node-locked licenses are instead locked to specific machines, meaning that the license key can only be activated by 3 machines in this example. You would need to deactivate one machine before another employee can access the application with that node-locked license key. So now you've heard me talk a lot about license keys, but what if you instead want to implement an account-based licensing model, where you let customers sign in using a username and password instead of a license key? Well, in Cryptolens, that actually works in much of the same way. You can implement any licensing model and set up account-based licensing using our thorough implementation guide. Essentially, when you allow a customer to sign in using a username and password, the software licensing system stores all of that customer's license keys under the hood, and your application is able to verify whichever license key is relevant at that specific time. This is good if you sell multiple products and you don't want to send a customer a million different license keys. And it is also good if you have a web application alongside your desktop app to make sure customers are able to sign in with the same username and password for both the web and desktop app. Now, there is actually one more licensing model that I would like to mention, which is the SDK licensing model, where you can charge per installation of the product. I've already made a video on the SDK licensing model that you can check out, and please also feel free to check out some other videos we have on this YouTube channel. Now, if you want to implement a licensing model for your software product, I have linked to a playlist in the description where we tell you how to implement any licensing model for free within minutes. I'm Joe Norman with Cryptolens. Thank you for watching. Stay curious.